Hello, I am Sanju B. Naik, Assistant Professor in Mechanical Engineering Department, Walchand of Technology, Solapur. In this video, I am explaining static load capacity of rolling contact bearings. At the end of the session, learners will be able to derive the equation for static load carrying capacity of ball bearings. Static load is the load acting on stationary shaft. So whenever the shaft is stationary, whatever load is acting on shaft is defined as static load. So if you see that this is a static load, when it is acting on the shaft, it is acting on the bearing, on the balls and the races. So these are the balls which support the static load, like P1, P2, P3, etc. So this load from the ball is acting on the races, and as the load is acting between contact point, we find there is a deformation of the ball and races. So as this load increases, the values of P1, P2 also increase, and that's why the deformation at particular point of contact will also increase. So if this deformation goes beyond certain allowable limit, then the performance of the bearing is lost. And then bearing may start giving vibrations and noise. And that's why, for all practical purposes, this deformation should have some allowable limit beyond which it should not be allowed. And by past experience, it has been found that the maximum allowed limit for this deformation is 0.0001 of the ball diameter. That means whatever the maximum load is acting at particular ball and race point of contact, there the maximum deformation is expected, and that maximum deformation should have a limited value equal to 0.001 of the ball diameter. And that's why the static load carrying capacity of the bearing is defined as the static load which corresponds to a total permanent deformation of balls and races at the most heavily stressed point of contact equal to 0.0001 of the ball diameter. Stribek has provided analysis for estimation of the static load. He has derived an equation by which we can calculate the static load acting on the bearing, or static load which can be supported by the bearing. He has made certain assumptions in his analysis that the races are rigid and retain their circular shape under applied load. So it has been sure that whenever the load is acting between point of contact, deformation is there. However, he made the assumption that the races will maintain their circular shape and they don't consider the change in the radius of curvature. So that is, rigid races will remain as it is. The second assumption he has made is the balls are equally spaced, that these balls are arranged in a bearing having the same angle between the adjacent balls, and that's why they are positioned at equal angle, and that's why they are equally spaced. The third assumption he has made is the balls in the upper half do not support the load. As the load is acting downward on the bearing, the balls in the upper half will not contribute this load. Only the balls which are arranged in the lower half will contribute the load. And that's why they are being subjected to forces P1, P2, P3, etc. And all these balls will be only considered on the bottom half. Now, look to this figure, that as the load is acting downward, the load acting on the balls will be shown in this direction, P1, P2, P3, etc. So just let us recall the resolution of forces, because P1 is acting vertically up, whereas P2, P3, they are acting as inclined forces. So this is a vertical force. So P1 is acting exactly as a vertical force. This is inclined force. That's why we know that we have to resolve into two compounds. So P2, P3, etc. are there, which are acting inclined. So vertical components must be, vertical and horizontal components we have to calculate for inclined forces. So look, this figure is the P2 is acting along this line, even P3 is also acting along this line. Now pause and think that, can we take full force P2 to support CO? That is, if I want to support CO, can I consider P2 as a force to support entire value? Let us consider the equilibrium of forces in vertical direction, because this vertical force has to be supported by all these balls in opposite direction, that is the vertical direction. So equilibrium equation will be C0 equal to P1, because already it is in vertical direction, whereas the P2 is acting along inclined line. It is to be resolved into component vertical and horizontal, and here vertical component of P2 will support C0. So that vertical component of P2 is P2 cos of beta. So P2 cos of beta, because beta is angle between this vertical plane and line. So cos beta component. So P2 cos beta. P2 cos beta of this P2 and P2 cos beta of this ball. It is a 2P2 cos of beta. Similarly, P3 is making angle 2 beta with vertical line, and that's why its component is cos 2 beta. So P3 cos 2 beta is vertical force. Here also vertical force. That's why it is 2P3 cos of 2 beta. So how many balls are arranged at the lower half, they will contribute the components. Now because of these loads P1, P2, etc., there is a deformation at the point of contact between the ball, this, etc. So it is, once again, delta 1 is the proportionate deformation according to P1, delta 2 is proportionate deformation according to P2, and once again, being the same angle between them, we get delta 2 by delta 1 is equal to cos of beta. Now it has been found that the deformation because of the load at the point of contact is proportionate, as delta is proportionate to load raised to 2 by 3. This has been found by Hertz contact stresses. So according to Hertz, he found that the deformation is proportional to load into 2 by raised to 2 by 3. So therefore, delta 1 is C1 P1 raised to 2 by 3, and delta 2 is C1 P2 raised to 2 by 3, and delta 2 by delta 1 will give this P2 upon P1 raised to 2 by 3. And also we know that delta 2 by delta 1 is also cos of beta, and therefore we get P2 by P1 raised to 2 by 3 is cos of beta, and hence P2 is equal to P1 cos of beta raised to 3 by 2. So if I use this equation, I can found that I can find that P2 is equal to P1 cos of beta 3 by 2. Similarly, P3 is equal to P1 cos of 2 beta raised to 3 by 2. So we get component P2, P3 in terms of P1 and angle. So substituting in equation of equilibrium, we find that C0 is P1. It was 2P2 cos beta. So 2P2 is this value, P1 cos beta raised to 3 by 2 into cos beta. It was 2P2 cos 2 beta. So it is 2P1 cos 2 beta raised to 3 by 2 into cos of 2 beta, and so on. So we just replace P2, P3 value in terms of P1, and we get this equation. So we get here P1 common, 1 plus 2 cos of beta raised to 5 by 2, because it is a 3 by 2 and this cos beta, it makes 5 by 2 plus 5 by 2, 2 cos 2 beta 5 by 2, and so on. So being a beta constant for given number of balls arranged in 360 degree, the angle between two balls will be constant, and that's why this bracket will be constant, substituted as M. So M is substituted as this bracket. And now if I consider Z is the number of the balls, then beta is found out by 360 by number of balls. So normally in a bearing we find that the balls numbers are 8, 10, 12, 15 something, for which we get particular value of M. And if I get Z by M ratio, we find it is almost constant, 4.35, 4.36, etc. So it is almost constant. So this is considered by Strebeck as phi o. So m is z by phi o. So we know that C naught is P1 m. So m is replaced by z by phi o. So I get static load capacity C naught is equal to P1 z by phi o. Now we know that by experiential evidence that whatever maximum deformation is limited to 0.0001 times the diameter of the ball, we find that the maximum load corresponding to that deformation is kd square. P1 is equal to kd square. D is a ball diameter, k is a factor depending upon the material. And that's why if I substitute, C0 is equal to kd square by z. So finally we found that the static load capacity C0 can be calculated by bearing construction having the material constant and D is the diameter of ball and Z is the number of ball. So this is known as Strebeck equation to estimate the static load capacity of bearing. So these are my reference. Thank you.